Hi everyone, this is Puneet. Today we will briefly discuss the basic concepts of heat treatment and what exactly the process is. So if you are unable to hear me or listen me, do you have any trouble with this audio functions, please let the skill link people know so that they can rectify as of very in the beginning of the webinar. Okay, let's not delay it and dive into what today we are going to learn in this webinar. We will see what exactly is a heat treatment means, what exactly it means to a layman, what exactly it means to an engineer. We'll see what different kinds of processes are involved in this heat treatment, and we will see how the fundamentals of this heat treatment are correlated with the manufacturing industry. We will see some different kinds of quenching media. How do you quench? How do you cool a substance on an industrial level? We'll see different kinds of surface modifications as well. And I am particularly interested in one particular case study of carburizing. So we'll go through it. There are, and followed by that, we have a lot of applications, and I have jotted down a bunch of market scenarios that we're going to do today. So let's quickly jump into what exactly and how heat treatment has evolved over years. Before I start anything, you have to ask yourself, so what are the ways in which we can alter the mechanical properties? I'm sure by this time most of you know, how do you alter the mechanical properties of a given piece of steel or a aluminum or any metallic plate. So just so you know, we'll restrict all our confinement materials here as metallic and non-metallic substances, and let's not talk about polymers, composites and ceramics. You know, those will be restricted just for this webinar purpose. So what happened in the early 1800s, it was the time of steel, it was mostly the Iron Age, so all the government officials wanted to do good at the war. So they asked to increase the hardness for this barrel extenders and also suppressors. They have given a piece of steel to a layman. He was actually a forger, or I think he might be a blacksmith as well, because that were the professions of the metal workers back in 1800s and 1790s. I just use the word engineer so that, you know, you, me and myself, everyone could relate what is going on. So he has done some bunch of experiments, and literally he achieved 40% more harder steel, which was very surprising at that time. And I also use the term here, he performed some experiments, because those were not even called experiments, and there was no such, you know, MPC, BIPC engineering and all that stuff back in 1800s. So the experiments what he conducted, later on scientists have investigated and called it as heat treatment process, which we are gonna read now. There are very pretty much interesting cases on how heat treatment processes evolved, but let's restrict our topic to this particular scenario and how steels have been emerged over the year. So what do I mean whenever I say a heat treatment process? It's very simple. You have to remember only three words. Believe me, this will be very simple if you just know these three words throughout the webinar. Just remember, heat treatment means heating, soaking, cooling. That's it. All you have to learn is. So you have to heat a particular thing, soak it, and then cool it. Boom, your heat treatment is done. This is what I call it as the most simplest process to change any mechanical properties. So what is a raw material for a heat treatment process? Why are we doing it? So there are many industries, you know, which come to you as a consultant or as a third party, or you yourself might be a part of a big industry. So they give you a piece of steel, they don't want the steel, or let's say, you know, they have to change the hardness. And then what you're going to do? I know there are a lot of ways in which you can alter the mechanical properties, like I said, but, you know, heat treatment is one of them. So you just have to heat it, soak it, and then cool it. So you will get the required mechanical properties. So when I say the mechanical properties are changed, it can be either an increase or a decrease. So it just depends how you operate this heating, soaking and cooling stage. I again repeat, heat treatment is very simple. All you have to remember is three stages. So whenever I say heat treatment, it is nothing but heating plus soaking plus cooling stage. I think you might know what heating and cooling is. I'll just debrief you as we go further. But what I mean in the soaking stage, this is kind of tricky thing. Because soaking means the main object in a soaking period is what you do is you just hold the metal to a proper temperature until it has, you know, reached the temperature, internal temperature. So you just hold it for a while. And like the flowchart says here, the metal is in the room temperature in the leftmost side of the slide. So you heat it, you then soak it, you cool it, you'll get the metal with the required mechanical properties. That required mechanical properties can be a higher value or lower value than the one which was previously non-heat treated, right? So we'll see what these stages actually mean as we proceed through the slides. Remember, properties can be increased or can be decreased in this process. You have to be careful on how the heating is done, how the soaking is done, and how the cooling is done. That is all you have to remember. So whenever you walk in an industry, they say there is a heat treatment or there's a heat treatment furnace. All you have to remember is, okay, they are heating something, they are cooling something, and they are soaking. That's it. And you're done. Let me walk you through the different stages in a heat treatment process. First comes the heating stage. The heating stage main principle is, if I give you a steel piece, iron piece, or aluminum steel casing, or a differential shaft, or whatever the part is, you have to make sure that it is heated uniformly. What happens if you heat unevenly? So one section can expand faster than other. It can result in a distortion, and there are a lot of dimensional tolerances that takes place when you talk about intricate parts and complex shapes. And as the slides say, it is very commonsensical thing that you have to make sure that you don't reach the melting point. Let's say I have a pure iron which melts at 1545 degrees Celsius or 1538 degrees Celsius. So you have to make sure that if I give you a piece of iron at 25 degrees Celsius, it's a room temperature, the heat treatment will be of course greater than room temperature, 25 degrees Celsius, and less than the melting point. You don't want the metal piece to melt all the way because it will lose its shape. And you definitely need to have an equipment, and the most widely used equipment are furnaces and ovens. There are different kinds of furnaces, and if you guys are interested in heat transfer and mass balance, this is the place where you have to put your head start. Parts where you heat in the furnaces is where actually all the thermodynamics and mass transfer, heat transfer comes into picture. And the most important thing that I would like to say, especially for ferrous, is the section A. The cross sections part is very important. Like I said, if you have a cross sections with a complex shapes, you have to make sure that you heat it evenly. And that is why we have a soaking period. Let's say you have a complex part of L shape or an I shape and only one joint, and your main principle is to achieve 1000 degrees Celsius, and only one joint has achieved 1000 degrees Celsius and all the remaining part is only at 950 degrees Celsius. So there is a 50 degrees Celsius temperature difference. So what do you do in a soaking period? You put it and you just lay it for another hour or so, so that all the parts are uniformly heated. The heat has to be traveled all the way from outside of the furnace to within inside. So that is what soaking period means, which is just after heating stage. Otherwise, you will have distortions, wraps, cracking. There is no proper dimensional tolerance. And the B point, which I have written here, is mostly for non-ferrous metals, which is like aluminum, copper, bronze, tin, because you don't want to heat them unevenly, so we consider their heat conductivity. And obviously the metal which has high heat conductivity will have a faster heating rate. So that is all about heating stage. Let's directly go into the cooling stage. Heating, soaking is done. Now the only thing is remaining is you have to cool it. So the way how you cool governs the final properties. So again, in heating, soaking, heating and soaking are all right, but cooling is really the game changer here. So there are n number of ways in which, you know, you can bring a 1000 degrees Celsius heated metal to a room temperature, because finally you want to touch your product, right? You don't want your product to be burning at 1000 degrees Celsius and you want to use it, unless and until we are talking about super alloys and nickel alloys. So we have to cool them necessarily. That's a mandatory thing. So usually what we do is we either take the help of the matter that is present around here, like air, water, oil, to cool it. There are different kinds of cooling media. And the way in which we cool is how the heat treatment process has been classified. The quenching media, the cooling rate are very important. And the way how the cooling is done is how the heat treatment process has been classified. Now things get interesting from here. So when you heat it, soak it, and slowly cool it, you call it annealing. When you heat it, soak it, and slowly cool it, you call it as annealing process. Now, when you heat it, soak it, and then rapidly quench it or rapidly cool it, you call it as hardening and quenching process, which is the third one. And if you cool it somewhere in between slow and fast, let's say moderate or relatively faster, then it's called normalizing. So there are basically three different types of heat treatment. I mean, there are three different ways in which you can do. So if I ask you what kind of heat treatment is going on, then you either have to choose whether it's an annealing process or normalizing process or a hardening process. Hardening or hardening and quenching, both are same. The heating and soaking will be same, no matter where you are, no matter in which country you are, no matter in which zone you are. If you cool it very slowly, then you call it as an annealing. If you cool it relatively faster than the annealing process, then it's called normalizing. If you cool it like really fast, then it's called a hardening process. And next comes the tempering process. Tempering, actually, I would like to call it as a reheating because it is always followed by quenching. You can't leave the products after quenching just to sit like that. We'll discuss more about what tempering is and why it is called reheating. And the fifth one is surface hardening or surface modification process. So in all these processes, the only thing necessary is the cooling rate. Especially for 1, 2, 3, that is how they have been classified. I'm sure most of you might have heard all these names, but the easiest way to remember is slow cooling annealing and fast cooling or rapid cooling is hardening. And somewhere in between, slow cooling means annealing, rapid or fast cooling means hardening. And somewhere in between, if you cool it, you call it as a normalizing. Surface hardening or surface modification is just when you want to alter the surface properties and nothing else. But we will go through all these processes again. The only thing you want to remember here is the cooling rate. The way in which you cool governs all these types of heat treatment. Before we get anything into further or more into surface modifications, let's talk about the mechanical properties which we were discussing earlier. So whenever I give you a piece of metal, what exactly are you looking for as an engineer? You know how to design it, you know how to properly align it, you have all the skills, necessary skills, you know, to use CAD CAM and to design it, to bring it into a proper shape. But that is not a final engineer requires. There are some properties, especially the mechanical properties, which we have to. So the main industrial properties that anyone looks at is, hey, his hardness, okay. How is the ductility or how is the toughness? And is there a way that I can machine it properly without getting any brittle fractures? And there are some other mechanical properties that we should also look into, like work hardening and formability. But let's restrict only to these properties. I would say let's restrict only to hardness and ductility. So just as a thumb rule, I would like to say in most of the ferrous and non-ferrous alloys, just as a thumb rule, but this is not the usual case. I'm again telling you, more hardness means less ductile. This is not a universal thing. This is not a fact. This is not a truth. This is just like a thumb rule. That's it. So whenever I give you a piece of steel, I say, hey, this is more hardness. So the thing that has to trigger is, oh, this might be less ductile. So more hardness means less ductile. That means it has more brittle. If you are unable to machine it very hard, you cannot peel the surface. You cannot make them into any shapes. Failure in a brittle way, which we don't want. We usually, what industries, especially anywhere in the world, try to do is they try to bring an optimum of all these properties. We don't want the material to be too hard. We don't want the material to be too soft. We want everything in an optimum durability. And when I say ductility, ductility means, like, you know, the basic definition, right? Ductility without breaking and or going into plastic deformation, the ability to retain the shape. When you beat a metal or a metallic piece, it has to undergo a particular shape. If it's not going, that means it is resisting. That means it doesn't have ductility. Ductility is ability to make into any shapes. Let's just put it that way, in a simple way. So these are the properties that I am looking as a heat treatment engineer. So whenever I give you a piece of steel, my end product should be like, whether it has a higher hardness than the original one, whether it has a greater ductility than
original piece I have given you. So if you are able to bring like optimum of both the properties, then it's well and good. Usually hardness is at an expense of ductility, and ductility is an expense at the rate of hardness. So just as a thumb rule, remember, whenever I say in this webinar, more hardness means less ductile, we can discuss more about it later, right? So everyone okay? And let me again wrap you with this. Slow cooling means annealing, moderate cooling means normalizing, and rapid cooling or fast cooling means hardening and quenching. These are the types. So how do we achieve these mechanical property relations? Like I said, now I want a higher hardness. I give you a piece of steel and you told me that, yes, sir, I can do a heat treatment and give you a higher hardness. So how do you do that? The only thing we all know till in heat treatment until now is you just have to heat it, soak it and cool it. That's it. And you know different kinds of process. I mean, if you slow cool it, you say it as a annealing, but that's not helping me. I want the customer, I want everyone to show what exactly these mean, right? So if I want to have less hardness, which means, okay, here comes a lot of adjectives. It's just playing with the language and nothing else. If I want to have a softer product, I have to do the slow cooling. So remember, slow cooling, softer product. So if I have to get a higher hardness than the original one, you want to go to faster cooling. If you want to just improve the hardness, like relatively than the soft one and relatively than the original one, but not too high, too hard, so that it brittles or it can just crack it when you drill it or when you machine it. So then you go for a normal cooling. So the faster the cooling rate, the more the hardness, the lesser soft and the less ductile. You have to remember this. Slow cooling means a softer product. Faster cooling means higher hardness. So which brings back, slow cooling means which process again? It's called annealing. So whenever I give you a piece of steel and I say, hey, can you anneal it? Then you have to remember that, oh, the hardness is going to drop. Is that okay? That is what you have to ask your customers. And if they say, yeah, that's absolutely okay, you just have to anneal it. Go ahead and do it. The original hardness was 30. You anneal it, you will get 25. And if that's okay with the customer, then go ahead. Now, if the original hardness is 30 and the customer requirement is to make the hardness 50, then definitely you are not supposed to slow cool it. You have to faster cool it. You have to cool it as fast as you can. Now, the requirement is only till, let's say, like, you know, 35. 30. Yeah. For a piece of steel, if I give you and the hardness, initial hardness is 30. And I wanted to make it at 35 to 40, then it's not softer and it's not like too hard, like 50 or 58 or 60. Then you may want to go with the normal cooling or air cooling. So the faster the cooling rate, the higher the hardness will be, which means it is less soft and which also means that the material is less ductile, right? So you have to get this thing straight. These are usually the mechanical property relations or the correlations that we usually have. And how am I tying this to the process? So slow cooling means a softer product, which means this is an annealing process. So the end product of annealing is always a softer product. And like the name suggests, hardening and quenching, it has a faster cooling. It has rapid cooling from here in this slide. So that means this gives you like a very hard product. It has like an ultimate hardness than the original one. Like you can't even, it's a completely whole new product than which you have started with the heat treatment. And what exactly are you doing in the heat treatment? You're just heating, soaking and cooling. The way in which you control the cooling rate determines your final mechanical property. That's it. You slow cool it, softer. You rapidly cool it, you get a high hardness value. So again, when I say high hardness, that means less ductile from this slide. Let's dive more into how this quenching media and how cooling rates have been affected. So whenever I heat a piece and I soak it, a steel piece, a big differential shaft or a big huge component. And what I usually do is in the hardening and quenching process, I throw that part either in a brine solution, like a salt solution or water in oil, or I'll expose it to a gas so that it cools itself. Just think of a ways on how you cook and you want to, you know, cool it. You can just put the lid on the pot that can still cool it, but it can take a longer hours. You can still put it in a, like, how do we, okay, I'm just trying to figure out a good example. How do we cool a glass of milk? You can just put it in a water solution, right? So that it sucks out all the heat and the warm milk it becomes lukewarm, or you know, whatever the degree of cooling we require. If you don't want cooling, you can just put a lid on it. It'll still be hot for a longer time, but it eventually cools down. Or you can just open the flap up or the lid up. It'll still cool down because of the air. So there are the different methods you can cool a steel piece industrially. One, you can just air cool it. You can just remove the piece and throw it out in the air, which is like the air cooling. Or you can still put everything in the furnace itself and close the furnace doors, which is like putting a flap or a lid on a glass of milk or on a pot. That's called air cooling. And next comes this quenching media, which is the quenching rate, how the quenching rates have been affected. So the first comes the brine solution. You can just throw all the pieces into a salt solution, or you can throw everything in water and also in oil and also in gas. Just a simple experiment, take a glass of milk and, you know, put it in a freezing water, or next put the same glass of milk with the same, you know, degree Celsius in a salt solution. You can see the salt solution has a faster cooling rate because the salts absorb all the heat in the water. So the oil has the slowest cooling rate because it has a lot of, you know, viscosity and turbulence, drag force, buoyancy forces, all mechanical things, properties, fluid dynamics comes in this picture. Industrially, no one uses gases and brine solution. I mean, commercial industrial heat treaters mostly don't use gas and brine because they cool the parts like really fast. Like from 1000 degrees Celsius to room temperature, it can happen within 30 minutes, which is like really, really fast. You don't want the parts to be cooled really fast because of the temperature gradient, stresses can be developed, and because of internal stresses, you don't know when crack can happen in the application or in the service. So we always try to see that it's not fastly cooled. And most of the industries, especially in India, USA, Europe, everywhere, we use oil as much as we can. Water for different applications. It depends if you really want a faster thing.